Our speaker today is Adriana Bonfili. She is a pharmacist by training and received her master's in cosmetic science and technology from the University of Ferrara. Since 1995, she has worked at the Institute of Skin and Product Evaluation. And for the past 20 years, she has been the clinical trial manager at ISPE. Her talk today will be on the safety of cosmetics, a fabulously interesting topic. So without further ado, Adriana, let me start up your slides and we can get you started. All right, take it away.
Okay, can I start?
Yeah, you can get started.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. My name is Adriana Bonfigli, and I'm Product Evaluation Manager at ISPE Laboratory. My lecture is about the in vivo safety and efficacy test from a general point of view. I hope this topic is of interest of you. Hopla. ISPE stands for Institute of Skin and Product Evaluation, was set up in Milan in 1989, and since then we performed innocuity, efficacy and sensory analysis on cosmetics and on raw materials. Most of our tests are in vivo tests. About the efficacy and the innocuity of cosmetic products, I would start by quickly recalling that in Regulation 1223, it is said that cosmetics must not cause damage to human health when applied under normal condition of use. It is also stated that the PIF, the product information file, must contain proof of the effect claimed for the cosmetic products. In this regard, we recall that in 2013, an additional regulation was issued by the European Commission, the regulation number 655 dealing with cosmetic claims. It laid down common criteria for the justification of claims used for cosmetic products, with the objective to guarantee a high level of protection for the end users. Later, in 2017, the Subworking Group on Claims issued a technical document on cosmetic claims. The purpose of this document is to provide guidance for the application of Commission Regulation 655. According to this regulation, claims on cosmetic products should conform to the following criteria: legal compliance, truthfulness, supporting evidence, honesty, fairness, and informed decision making. In brief, claims should be useful, understandable, clear, relevant, reliable. They should enable users to take informed decision and to make an informed choice. Different types of evidential supports can be used to support the cosmetic claims. It is usual to substantiate claims by using either experimental studies or consumer perception tests or published information or a combination of these. Experimental studies include studies in silico, in vitro, ex vivo, in vivo on volunteers with instrumental methods, investigator evaluation, and sensory evaluations. Such studies should comprise methods which are reliable and reproducible. The studies should follow a well-designed and scientifically valid methodology according to best practice. The criteria used for the evaluation of product performances should be defined with accuracy and chosen in accordance with the aim of the test. Whatever the type of study, it is important that the person conducting the study has the appropriate qualifications, training and experience, and has ethical quality standards and professional integrity. Study conducted on volunteers should follow ethical principles and should comply to specific ethical documents, Declaration of Helsinki and Good Clinical Practice. The Declaration of Helsinki, adopted in 1964 by the World Medical Assembly, is the ethical recommendation guiding physicians in biomedical studies. The aim is to protect the health of the subject participating in trials, avoiding any risk for them. Before starting the test, all the information related to safety of products and ingredients should be checked. Furthermore, the unwanted effects must be monitored, and in case of unexpected reactions, the procedure to follow and the medical assistance must be established before the beginning of the study. Study participants must be well informed and grant written acceptance form by signing the informed consent. Human studies should be conducted on the target population and should be defined by strict inclusion and exclusion criteria. Typical inclusion criteria are age, age range, sex, health state, no pathological events before or during the study, and specific inclusion criteria are the presence of particular skin condition as photoaging, wrinkles, cellulite, hair loss, dandruff, oil or dry skin, etc., etc. Typical exclusion criteria are the systemic assumption of drugs, skin disorders, pregnancy or breastfeeding women in compliance with the ethical requirement of the Declaration of Helsinki. Human studies should be conducted on a statistically representative sample of the target population. Low number of data affects the result of the statistical analysis. Typically, for instrumental tests, almost 20 subjects is required, and for consumer tests, more than 100. Protocols. In vivo tests should be conducted under standardized conditions described in a clear and detailed protocol. Clear description of the objective of the study, methodology, subject selection, application schedule, test articles should be documented as well as the statistical analysis of the data. A randomized controlled trials in humans is the gold standard to be used whenever applicable. Blinding is the procedure in which one or more parties to the trial are kept unaware of the treatment assigned. Single blind refers to the subject being unaware to the assignment, while double blind refers to the subject and investigator being unaware to the assignment. The trial should be carried out by comparing a product against placebo, that is the product without active ingredient, or an inactive formula. When a performance claim is due to a specific ingredient, the comparison with the placebo is strictly required. It is useful to take into consideration relevant guidelines relating to instrumental techniques, as EMCO guidelines. EMCO is the European Group on Efficacy Measurements and Evaluation of Cosmetic and Other Products. It is a group of professionals, independent experts from private and public areas of the Europe with special competence in the field of the assessment of cosmetics and other products impacting human skin. We also consider the COLIPA guidelines about the safety and efficacy of cosmetic products. In vivo tests, based on the selected methodology, instrumental, subjective, and clinical evaluation can be performed. Let's start with the clinical evaluation. It typically is an in-use test under medical observation of dermatologists, ophthalmologists, dentists, or gynecologists, depending on the type of product to be tested. The clinical observation of the skin is made at the baseline and after the product application period. Scoring scales are used by the evaluation for grading the skin features as the erythema, edema, the squamation, or photoaging, baldness, cellulite, acne, etc., etc. In the clinical evaluation, some standard photographic scales are often used. For example, the Larnier 6-point photographic scale for grading the skin photodamage, or the Bathing Doublet Atlas for wrinkles, or the Ludwig scale for the baldness, the female baldness, or the Norwood-Hamilton scale for the male baldness. And then the Leeds scale for acne, and the Narberger-Müller pinch test for cellulite. The evaluation of the safety on cosmetic products is carried out through two different approaches: in use test according to the usual condition of use, or epicutaneous test, in which an exaggerated exposition to the products is used according to different modalities: single application, repeated applications, occlusion, semi-occlusion, or open. In epicutaneous test, commonly called patch test, the products are applied into cells placed on the adhesive patch. The patch is applied on the skin back of the subject for different lengths of time, for example, 24, 48, or 72 hours. After the patch removal, the visual observation of the skin is made to evidence the onset of erythema, edema, desquamation, or other signs of irritations. Patch tests are the most used test to screen the skin compatibility but of cosmetic products. Patch tests are cheap and easy to do, but are not so easy to understand. Sometimes it happens that the patch test does not evidence any skin reactions, while some discomfort reactions are observed when the product is applied under normal condition of use on the target skin site. This is especially true for products for the eyes area or for the lips. For this reason, our suggestion is to carry out both the patch and the in-use test. If you have to choose one of them, surely the in-use test gives more useful information on the compatibility of the test products. Let's see what the technical document says about the most used safety claims. The claim tolerance tested means that the product is tested for tolerance under the supervision of qualified professional. The claim test under medical supervision is clear. The claim dermatologically tested means that the product is tested on human under the supervision of dermatologist. And the claim clinically tested means that the product is tested on humans under medical supervision according to a clinical protocol or in a clinical setting. Two words about hypoallergenic claim. It's a very controversial claim. It is widely used but is not so much appreciated by the scientific community. Let's see what is the opinion of the technical document about the use of the hypoallergenic claim. It must be used for cosmetic products designed to minimize its allergic potential, first. Second, the presence of no allergens or allergen precursor should be totally avoided. Third, it does not guarantee a complete absence of risk of an allergic reactions, and the product should not give the impression that it does. Two more words about the use of the human data in the assessment of the skin sensitization. Reference should be made to the Scientific Committee Consumer Safety 1567 Memorandum about Use of Human Data and Risk Assessment of Skin Sensitization. This document says that for ethical reasons, predictive sensitization tests should not be undertaken in vivo because of the risk to induce sensitization in healthy subjects. And now, let's go to the magic word of the instrumental evaluation and claims substantiations. Instrumental evaluations imply the use of bioengineering instruments chosen on the basis of the investigated parameters. These devices are non-invasive techniques which give information about the skin structure and functions. The aim of the instrumental evaluation is to prove the efficacy of a product with relation to a claimed parameter. As strength point of the instrumental evaluations, we can say that is a multi-device evaluation in which different parameters can be assessed on the same group of subjects, and the objectivity of the result and the statistical validation of the claimed effect. And then, on the contrary, the weak points are that the devices require periodic calibrations and trained technicians, and that they are influenced by environmental conditions. This requires that all the measures must be carried out in a controlled room with fixed values of temperature and humidity. The selection of the device depends on the investigator parameters, which must be relevant to the effect of the product and to the claim. Here, there are few examples of the correspondence between instrumental techniques and the claims. I leave some seconds to read the slide. Now let's see some application of the about instrumental evaluation. There are many tools on the markets used for the testing the cosmetic efficacy. I'm here reported a few of them, but it does not mean that the other tools are not valid. Let's start with products for the face care. Skin hydration. The skin hydration can be measured by corneometer or moistometer. Corneometer is based on the physical principle of capacitance. It measures the amount of water in the stratum corneum. Moistometer is based on the physical principle of dielectric constant of the skin, and it measures the amount of water to a depth of 1 millimeter. Here there is the kinetic of the hydration. We see that the values go up where an improvement is observed, go down for a worsening, stay as no effect on the skin hydration. And then the skin elasticity. Cutometer measures the viscoelastic properties of the skin. The skin is sucked into a probe by a negative pressure for a few seconds. Then the skin is released to this original position. The cycle suction release are shown on Cartesian axis, where the deformation of the skin is a function of time. In the studies of the skin barrier properties, the most useful parameter is the transepidermal water loss. It is the amount of water evaporating through skin to the external due to the water vapor gradient of the skin barrier. It is a sensitive indicator of skin irritation and of the barrier damage. It is widely used in analysis of irritancy potential and to evaluate the protective and the soothing effect of topical products. we will see in the slide that the value of transepidermal water loss increase in case of damaged skin, decrease in case of repaired skin or healthy skin, and stay equal for no effect on the transepidermal water loss. Then, anti-aging products. Skin aging is a complex biological process influenced by the combination of endogenous and exogenous factors. These factors lead to many and physiological alterations in the skin. For example, dryness, mottled discoloration, wrinkles, loss of tone and skin elasticity, dullness and saggy skin, and others. Then, the evaluation of the efficacy of the anti-age products involves many instrumental evaluation: skin elasticity, smoothness, wrinkles, color, hydration, skin density, etc., etc. Skin color. The evaluation of the skin color is made by colorimetry. The device works with a xenon light source and a color rating system, SILE-B, where L is the gray axis from black to white, A the red-green axis, and B the blue-yellow axis. The study of the skin surface is made with different techniques. Here there is an example of silicone replicas that are negative imprints of the skin surface and are analyzed by image processing software. It gives information about the typical roughness parameters R, RA, RZ, and so on. A more recent technique uses the digital stripe projection to carry out a three-dimensional analysis of the wrinkles, as shown in the slide. And then the skin density, the study of skin density, also called echogenicity, is made by ultrasound echography. The intensity of ultrasound echoes reflected by the different skin structure is visualized with pseudocolors, where the different colors represent different levels of echogenicity of the skin structures. Skin echography gives some information about the morphology of the different skin structures, epidermis, derma, and hypodermis. And now let's see some example for protocols to be used to test the body care products. First, the cellulite evaluation. Cellulite is a common aesthetic problem for many women. The cause of cellulite is still a matter of debate. It is currently considered an endocrine metabolic microcirculatory disorder that causes alteration and change in subcutaneous adipose tissue. It is characterized by orange peel aspect of the skin, loss in tone and elasticity, microcirculatory disorder, mainly on the skin of the buttocks and thighs. So the assessment of the efficacy of the treatment for cellulite involves many instrumental evaluation: skin elasticity, smoothness, microcirculation, thermography, skin density, etc., etc. Here we will see some instruments used to measure the blow microflow, the flowmeter laser Doppler, the thermography, infrared thermal camera, and the ultrasound echography we already used for the anti-age studies. And now hair care. The evaluation of their loss products is made with the phototrichogram technique. A special software analyzes the anagen and telogen hair in an area of the scalp after some hours from the hair shaving. The evaluation of the strengthening effect is made with different techniques. The pull test, that is the clinical evaluation of the hair resistance to tractions, and wash test, by which the number of hair lost during a controlled washing is counted. Finally, the diameter of the hair can be measured by scanning electron microscopy. Now we will see some protocols to evaluate the makeup products. In the makeup formulation, the evaluation of the performance at skin distribution, adhesion, lasting, covering, and water resistance is very important and requires a complex of several measurements. The mascara are very technical products with very high performances. Some effects can be evaluated with the analysis of length and surfaces on photos before and after the application of the mascara. For example, the lengthening effect can be measuring the distance between the rima palpebrarum and the point of maximum length of the lashes, and the curling effect by the evaluation of the curvature of the lashes, and the volumizing effect by the increase of the surface occupied by the lashes. The evaluation of the performances of colored products, as for example lipsticks, gloss, lip pencil, mascaras, foundation, and so on, are made by colorimetric evaluation made before and after. For example, the long-lasting effect at 8 hours can be measured by colorimetry before and after 8 hours from application. The product is considered long-lasting if the average percentage of color retention, that is the amount of the product left on the skin after 8 hours, is higher than equal to 90%. And the same for no transfer effect, the colorimetry before and after the repeated contact with the contour wipe, and for water resistant, the colorimetry before and after the water immersion, and the product is considered water resistant if the average percentage of color retention is higher than equal to 50%. A different evaluation is made to measure the glossy on the matte effect on the skin. The device based on light reflectance called glossimetry is used before and after the product application. And now some words about the use of digital images in the scientific studies. The illustration of the cosmetics effects with images is a much appreciated technique with a great impact on the consumers. Unfortunately, the images often do not comply with the indication of the good practice and of the image honesty. Illustration of the product's performance must not be misleading. The images must not be altered, and the procedure of acquisition of the images must be standardized for area, lighting, focus, and position. Now we will see some example of images that do not meet this criteria. In this example, we are observing evident difference in lighting between before and after in position, and evident alteration by Photoshop or something alteration software. Then another example, here there is a clear evidence of a slice of skin buttock is taken away by Photoshop or other program, and here there is the the comparison before and after of a foundation, but the images before and after are very different. While it is important that for the for a better comparison and for correct comparison, the images before and after must keep the same condition of hair, clothes, position, and light. The last type of evaluation we are going to see now is the subjective evaluation made by the users. This evaluation gives useful information about the performances and about the perceived efficacy of cosmetic properties. This is a very subjective evaluation because subjects' judgment is affected by individual expectation on different features such as packaging, texture, fragrances, and so on. The subjective evaluation must involve an appropriate number of subjects chosen according to the product targets. The questioner must have few questions and clear and not corrupted language. And then at the end of the test, quantitative claim must be supported by a statistical validation. At the end of the test, the instrumental data are collected and analyzed by mathematical and statistical analysis. The data recorded before and after the product application are statistically compared. The probability that the data are true is expressed with the p-value. Typically, the p-value is fixed at 0.05. It means that there is the 95% chance that the difference we observed reflects a real difference and the 5% chance that the difference is due to a chance. And last but not least, and we will see the some products. Let's take a look to the test supporting the claims of sun protection. For this category of products, the efficacy has a safety value because the lack of protective effect of a solar product can cause a damage to the skin of the consumers. We see a typical label of a sunscreen product. On the label, we will see a value, SPF sun protection factor value, and an optional claim of water resistance and required claim of UVA protection, the UVA logo. And the SPF test is in vivo test and is an ISO test, ISO 2444. And after the test in vivo, the experimental value is used to calculate the SPF to be put on the label according to the European recommendation. Then the water resistant test is the SPF in vivo with the ISO specific for the water resistant, that is the 1627. And then finally, for the UVA test, there is both in vivo and in vitro test. Both are ISO methods, and the difference in the last number. One is 3, the other one is 2. The following slide, we will see how is the correspondence between the experimental value obtained with the in vivo test and the value to be for the label. We will see the correspondence and also see that the European recommendation says that the minimum value of SPF is 6 and maximum value is 50 plus. And then to use the claim of UVA protection, the UVA protection factor must be higher than equal to 1/3 of the SPF labeled value. And the critical wavelength must be higher than equal to 370 nanometers. I'm sorry, but the slide is in Italian, but the number is the same. And then this year we'll see a lot of revisions and a lot of new release of the ISO. A short two words about the ISO. Do you see that we, unfortunately, for to support the safety and efficacy test, no official method exists? And in vivo, of course. Only for the sunscreen products, we have the ISO methods. And then we will see this, that the ISO 2444, this is for the SPF in vivo, it's recently revised. And also the UVI for UVI in vitro and the UVI in vivo that are will be revision without this year. And then new ISO about the water resistance, the water resistant in vivo and the calculation of water resistance percentage. Here we'll see about water resistance. Two words about the test. I'll remember that to claim water resistant, an immersion of 40 minutes must be made, and to claim very water resistant, a double immersion time of 80 minutes in a spa pool with a fixed condition of temperature. And to claim water resistant or very water resistant, the SPF after the immersion must be higher than equal to 50% of the SPF before the immersion. That is called static SPF. And then here the slide about the UVI in vitro. And UVI in vitro, according to the ISO 2443, is a measure of UV transmittance of the sunscreen applied on PMA plates, polymethyl methacrylate, and then analyzed with the ultraviolet transmittance analyze. And the sample are also exposed to UV, and then the UVR factor is measured before and after the UV exposure. And then this is my last slide, and two words about how COVID influenced our work. The procedure adopted for the laboratory sanitization from the assets of the volunteers to the laboratory led to a slowdown in work rates and to a lengthening of test times. Furthermore, there is a very important point that is related to the fear of the subject to undergo tests during which the distance between subject and technician is less than 1 meter. And thank you very much. I'm sorry if I go probably too quickly, but thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. I thought you did an excellent job. Nicely done. And I like to pretend I don't wear glasses, but indeed I do. Well, thank you so much for that. As you see, as you might not know, we got a ton of questions. And so we're going to go through and just cover them right now. So you hear me okay? We are going to try to get through as many questions as we can. We're going to keep you, Adriana, till the top of the hour. So let's just go with the first question here. First of all, is there some sort of book or reference that you would recommend that gives methods for testing cosmetic products?
No, not really a book, but articles, papers, publications, scientific works, and so on. Anyway, as I told in the presentation, there is the guidelines of EMCO ENCO group, no? This is guidelines are specific for each parameter. For example, there is the guideline for the skin hydration, for the transepidermal water loss, and so on. And then there is the guidelines of COLIPA, but as often happens, the guidelines are very general.
Yeah.
In some cases, this is not so useful, no, as we want, as we need. So we, of course, because of no official method exists to evaluate the safety and efficacy in vivo, and we, each laboratory has his internal protocols, but it's slight difference one each other because all the laboratory see the same works and the same papers and the same guidelines, so probably it's, they are different from very small details, but for example, patch test in some lab, the patch test is made after the single patch test after 48 hours, or in some case after 42 hours or 72 hours. But more or less, the method is the same, apart few details. Okay, but unfortunately, this is the problem, in my opinion, of the test, that there is no official method, and then each laboratory can work according, can make the test as they want.
Yeah, that is one of the challenges for a lot of things in cosmetics. Okay, we've got a number of questions, so let me just get through some of these. Frashant says, how does in silico studies benefit the toxicity of overall cosmetics research? Has in silico changed any of your R&D strategy?
I don't know, because I know there is in silico in vitro, but I'm very sorry, but my expertise is only for we in our lab we work only with the in vivo tests, so I don't have any expertise in silico. I'm very sorry.
It's okay. Here's a question. You presented the corneometer as a device. How repeatable are those corneometer measurements? Is it hard to get good results?
Yes, of course, all the measurements are very affected a lot of factors. For example, the technician, the pressure of the probe, and so on, the area. If you move from millimeters from 1 hour to another, it's different. For this, we use some skin mask to for the area. No, because in some case, for example, in an in-use test, no, probably a lot of time pass between the baseline and the measure after the product application. So we must be sure to find the exactly the same area, and then for this we use the mask. Yeah. And then of course all the instruments are calibrated, so I hope that
Well, I know in the experience I've had using the corneometer, and you had to get people to stay in a room for 8 hours and have the control thing.
It was
very challenging. Yeah.
Yes. No. Yes. Of course, we must respect all the indication, no, for the standardization process, of course. And then if there is the repeated measurements, for example, in a short time, no, for to evidence a short effect, the subject must stay all the time inside the controlled room, of course, because if they go out,
no exercising.
This is the same problem for all the devices. Very dependent from the environmental factors, and also from the technical factor due to the different operator. For this, it's very important that the test is made, the before and after test is made always by the same operator.
Yes. Okay, we have a question from David. He says that we use spectroscopy to measure multiple parameters on the skin in one treatment, such as hydration, lipids, and active penetration of proteins. Is using a spectroscopy measurements for skin, is that a new thing, or is that something that's frequently done?
For spectroscopy to measure hydration?
Yeah.
Yes, no, I think this is it's very used, but we don't have the spectroscopy, and then I don't report on the presentation because I don't have any expertise in this. Yes, but I know this is it's often used, but it's a very expensive tool, so
it's exactly.
Yes, it's a new instrument. The problem is that we have a lot of instruments already because we, as told at the beginning of presentation, we are from many years in the field of evaluation. So we have all the devices of Courage Kazaka, and then even if this device become superated, we can keep to make the studies. Of course, there is a lot of new instruments that are more modern and more sophisticated than the classic one. Okay.
Well, you've also developed an expertise in running these specific instruments, and as you've said, it's very difficult to do these studies without expertise.
Yes.
Okay, yes. Here's a question from Nikki. What is the industry standard for determining skin irritation, both in the EU and in the US? Is there differences there?
Skin irritation. I think so. I know that, for example, in the Italy or European area, the single patch test is very often used. While in USA, I think they use the repeated insult patch test. That is a repeated patch test. But yes, this is the, I don't know if you see, there is this note to the scientific committee that suggests do not perform the sensitization test in vivo, because there is the risk to induce a sensitization to healthy subjects. But the repeated insult patch test is this type of test, because it's a repeated insult patch test, but there is a repeated application of the product, no, for one, two, three weeks, exactly on the same site. And then there is a rest phase, and then there is a challenge phase, during which some allergic reaction can be seen. So it's a different approaches, but in my opinion, my personal, very personal opinion, no responsibility about my opinion. In my opinion, is the patch test, also the repeated patch test, is not so useful, because it's a standard test, and every kind of cosmetic products are applied under the same modalities. So you have no information about the skin site. If you have a product for example, for the hair or for the eyes or for the lip or for the face, it's very important to test it on the target population according to the normal condition of use, because this is the correct way to see if the product gives some problems during his use on the market, no? Because for example, if you have a subject with rosacea or with atopic skin or sensitive skin and so on, it's very different if the product is applied on the skin face or is applied off the skin back face, skin back skin. So in my opinion, I understand that a screening must be used, no?
Yes,
but if you will see the result of the screening, you don't have any information about the life of the product on the market.
Yes, good point. Pragna asked a similar question. I think What would you say is the gold standard today for measuring ocular irritation? Now that animal testing can't be done, so what is the gold standard now?
In vivo test with ophthalmologist control, with medical control. My opinion is yes, because I don't know which. I know that in some kind, we know that there is a head cam test, which is made on the choroidal membrane of the eggs and so on, which mime the conjunctival mucosa with a lot of blood and so on, veins. But in my opinion, the best, the gold standard is always the in-use test with the medical control by ophthalmology.
Okay, great, thank you. Okay, we just cut time for, we got about, I got 7 minutes. So we have time for a few more questions. Magali says, how can somebody choose the best composition for a placebo to keep that invisible if you're just evaluating for a raw material?
Okay, this is a good question, because when we perform a test or ingredients, no, we must select a basic formulation, no?
Yes,
because the formulation has two different aspects, must have two different aspects. One is the biodisponibility and the possibility that the ingredient is vehiculated in the formula, no? So it's made according to this point. It's the formulation must be correct for the ingredients, and because on the contrary, the ingredients stay on the formulation and does not go to the skin, okay? And on the other word, there is the problem that if the placebo formula it contains too many ingredients, no? Recipients, vehicles, it can have a positive effect on the skin features. For example, we will see that in some cases, placebos have a moisturizing power, no?
Yes.
Because the moisturizing is affected, yes, by some ingredients, not only the active ingredients, but every kind of ingredients. So
fatty alcohols, emulsifiers,
yes. So my suggestion is that the formula for the test must be, in case of when we test an ingredient, must be more simple, more possible, but with a look to the biodisponibility of the ingredients on the skin. Okay. Yeah. Of course, if we will test a finished cosmetic product, is a different point, because the cosmetics products are made by many ingredients, and the effect is due to a pool of actives, no? So it's difficult to make the classical placebo, no? It is the same formula without actives.
In
this case, in my opinion, the best is to use a base cream, no? Without many ingredients and so on, because it's impossible to have the placebo of of a finished product. Yes,
indeed. It's okay. Here's a question from Jonathan. I wanted to get a few more in before the end. We've got 5 more minutes here, but Jonathan, there's the claim instantly hydrates. It's a claim that moisturizers make. Can you use the corneometer to validate this claim?
Instant? What is the claim?
Instant. It means it happens right away, right when you put it on.
Yes. The problem of instant is how is an instant? It's a philosophy problem. How we measure an instant? No, but we, of course, we... we can fix, no, a short time of control. We usually wait for 30 minutes because the important is that the water of the products go away. No, if even if you measure the water of the products and not the hydration value of the skin, so we can measure the value after 30 minutes, for example, from the application, and for us this is an instant effect. Of course, do you know that to the claim to must be honest. And truthfully, you must say that instant with the
asterisk,
the instant stay for measurement after 30 minutes. No, this is the problem of claim, that is a problem of words, of wording.
Until we develop a time machine, yes, you have to do that. A time machine, you know. Okay, we have a question from Melanie. She says, sometimes when testing lipsticks, we use the colorimeter, but the results are okay, but it doesn't look right on the consumer. Is it recommended that use the colorimeter for testing color of lipsticks, or is there some other thing you can do?
I think that the colorimetry is a good technique to measure the color, because it's a specific technique to measure the color. But we use also the glossimeter, but the glossimeter is for the glossy, it's not for the color. No. Yeah. So, but the glossy is an important feature, no, of the lipstick, especially of the gloss. But we can measure the with the chromometer, the colorimeter, we can measure easily the color of any surface, so of the lips. Why not?
No? Exactly. Exactly. Okay, we got time for one question, maybe two. What instrument, now this is just more of a philosophical question, but what instrument would you love to see be invented that doesn't exist right now?
Water. Yes, I have the answer. The standardization machine.
Yes. So all the tests come out correctly.
Yeah.
Okay, I have just one more question and then we'll wrap up. Thank you so much to everybody who has joined us today. Thank you for your questions. I apologize if we didn't get to your question. We just run out of time. Hopefully you can attend our next webinar. If you want your question answered, get that question in early and we get to it. Okay, the final question here, and it could be a big one. What kind of progress is being made in replacing animal testing for safety testing?
For?
In the EU, they have outlawed animal testing for the safety of products. Yeah. Is there progress being made to replace some of the animal testing that we don't have good models for, like inhalation, for example?
It's a difficult question. It's the last, but it's very difficult.
Save the most difficult for last. You know what? I'll tell you what. We're actually going to do a whole webinar on animal testing. So I'm going to save you from that question. And why don't we just end it right now? And I'll give you the last word. If you have anything to say, we can let you say it. Okay. Well, thank you so much for your presentation.
No, I'm sorry. If I can say two words.
Please go ahead.
It's only, in my opinion, I think that when possible, the in vivo model is the best. That if I can use the product, I'm talking about the final products, not ingredients. Okay.
Yeah.
But yes. A part of that, the ingredients must be safe for the cosmetic law, no? But to see the combination, no, the combination of all the ingredients, the interaction and the mixture of the the ingredients. I think that best standard is to apply on the target skin of the subjects and see what is the reaction and the reaction of the between interaction between the skin and the products. I think that animals is not important in this phase, no?
Yeah.
Well, apart any consideration about the use of animals that of course are already made.
Yeah, no, I agree. Ultimately, the best test is the product tested on the people who are going to use it.
Yeah,
and that tells you the most, yeah.
Yes.
Well, Adriana, thank you so much. Thank you for sticking around, answering so many questions. Thanks for your wonderful presentation. We've got some great feedback. And I don't know if you guys celebrate the holiday, but happy holidays coming up. And I hope you stay safe related to the virus. And hopefully someday we're going to be able to travel again and we'll get to get out to that island. Where'd you say that island was? Right off the coast of Italy?
I'm you're sorry. From? No, I tried to say bye to everyone, but I cannot.
That's okay. We will see you next time. Thank you, everybody, for attending. And we will see you next week. We actually have another webinar next week. So look forward to that. We'll send an email on it. I'm Perry Romanowski. Thank you so much.
Thank you to you. Thank you to everybody. Thank you to you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye. Ciao, ciao.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the latest IFSCC webinar. We have an exciting webinar for you today. It's been a little while, but first, as we like to do, let's say hello. So let's see who's coming. Look at that. We got 7 people online already. It's coming quick. Hello, and if you're just joining us, I am Perry Romanowski, the Education Chair of the IFSCC.
Nicola, ma la chiudi la porta.
And we have Mary Lynn Hallen. She is also the Secretariat. And we also have our speaker, Adriana Bonfigli.
Bonfigli.
Bonfigli, okay.
I know that GL is difficult for Anglo-Saxon people, no? GL, Bonfigli.
Certainly is for a Polish guy like me.
Yes.
Well,
because your English is so wonderful that for me you are Anglo-Saxon.
Well, grazie, as they say. We have over 50 people are online. We are going to get started in just 10 minutes. But if you're just joining us, tell us, say hello. Let us know you're here in the chat room. Oh, we've got some people said chat. We got Philip. Hello, Philip. Say hello. Philip from Singapore, all the way from Singapore, Adriana.
Almost midnight in Singapore.
Really? Well, oh, and then we got Allison from Puerto Rico. Hello, Allison. Welcome aboard. We are going to get started in just 10
minutes.
I'm sorry.
You are going to share my presentation?
I will share your presentation, yes.
The last one I sent you.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
We've got that. And we're going to do that right at the top of the hour. So in 9 minutes. In the meantime, we're going to say hello. Ilian from Sweden. So now we've got Sweden, Puerto Rico, Singapore. Somebody from New Jersey. Bill from New Jersey. Mania from Romania. Hello.
Wow.
Adela, not Mania. Adriana, where are you located?
In Milan.
Milan. Oh, we were just in Milan, last October?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, for the IFSCC. Yeah. That was a wonderful event.
Okay, and I was born in Sardinia. Do you know there is an island like Sicily, a major island like Sicily, but it's Sardinia.
Like our friend Emanuele Piras.
Yeah, like
Emanuele Piras. Wow.
Well, that is so. Is it off the west coast of Italy or the east coast? Or is
it's between Italy and Spain.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Makes sense.
It's west coast.
USA, or as they say in Spanish, right? USA.
I've been told that the IPCE conference, which is jointly held by Japan, Spain, and Japan, Italy, and the United States, is probably going to be held in Sardinia next year or the year after. So that is an excuse to get to Sardinia.
Yes.
And
it's a very wonderful place. It's not because I was born there, but it's really a wonder. In my opinion, it's the best beaches and seas in Italy.
Well, it sounds wonderful. While we're waiting, we're going to get started here in just 7 minutes. I want to let you know you are tuned in to the IFSCC webinar series. Mary Lynn, this is what, our 14th one?
14th seminar.
14th seminar. You can go back and see all of the old ones. Go to our website, ifscc.org, and check out all our previous webinars. They have been wonderful, but not nearly as wonderful as today is going to be, right, Adriana? So, no pressure. But if you're just joining us, feel free to say hello. We've got Sharon from South Africa.
Yeah, Sharon's usually with us. Hi, Sharon.
Oh, hello. And then we have Didier from France. Hello. Sarah from Taiwan.
Pronounce Didier.
Oh, Didier. There you go. Well, welcome aboard. We are very excited to have Adriana today giving her talk. And we will be speaking right at the top of the hour. But before we get to that, Adriana, why don't you tell us, how did you get involved in the cosmetic industry?
How?
Yeah.
Yes. I met Luigi Rigano. No, Luigi Rigano is the head of the Rigano Laboratory is the consultant lab, and both of ISP lab, this is the testing lab. So I met Luigi many, many years ago at the specialization, the PhD school in Ferrara, where I attended to the cosmetic science specifications.
Oh, nice. Excellent. And your background was in, did you study chemistry or biology?
In pharmacy.
Pharmacy, okay.
Pharmacy, yes. Pharmacy, and then I went to Ferrara for the PhD in cosmetic science.
Oh, nice. I'm not familiar with that program. How long does it take to go through that program to get a PhD?
In the 1993, the course lasts for 2 years, and it is like a short university because there is a lot of exams, and we attend to the lessons. We are a very small class, and so on. So it's like a small university, a shorter university. Yes.
Well, it sounds like a wonderful program, and we are so happy to have you here. If you are just joining us, this is the IFSCC webinar, our 14th, and why don't you tell us where you're from? Say hello. We've got Paula from Mexico. Hello, Paula. Malta from, Mate. Hello, Mate from New York. We've got Syed from New Jersey. Chris from Singapore. Is Singapore the farthest one so far?
So far.
Although South Africa is far, at least for me, South Africa is far.
South Africa is far, but it's only a 6-hour time difference.
That's true. We are going to get started.
I'm sorry, where are you?
Oh, if you want to click on the chat, that icon is the third one from the top, then you can see where everyone else is from. We've got
I'm in New York City.
Shia from
India.
Oh, I am located in Chicago, Illinois. The center of the world, isn't it?
Yes.
I thought New York City was the center of the world, of the universe.
It's all the way to the right. We're in the middle.
I visit Chicago last December, 1 year ago.
Yeah. So it must have been nice and warm for you then.
No, not so warm. Not so warm than I expected. Yes. It's quite warm. It's acceptable temperature. No problem. Indeed. Yes.
Sometimes it can get pretty chilly. Today it is, I don't know it in Celsius, but it's about 40 degrees Fahrenheit. So.
40? So, yeah. I don't know. I'm not able to make the conversation.
I'm gonna guess it's about 18C, maybe? Yeah. It's my guess.
I don't know.
All right. Anyone in the audience, convert 40 Fahrenheit to Celsius.
No, it's a ratio. It's not so simple. It's less 42 ratio 11, something. But yeah. I really don't know.
Well, it's not warm.
I learned when I stay in the USA, but now I forgot.
It's okay.
I'm sorry.
Well, we are going to get started in just 2 minutes. I want to say hello to Monica from Boston. We got Montserrat from Barcelona. Oh, there we go. Look at Syed said 40F is equal to 4. It's equal to 4.44C. Hey, you know, 44 is my favorite number. Look at that. Look at that. Everybody's coming through, giving us some numbers. I love that people are paying attention.
Yes. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Gabriel. So, yes, it's 4 degrees here, 4 Celsius here. Well, just before we get started, we are first going to introduce Mary Lynn, and she's going to tell you a little bit about the IFSCC. But before we do that, I'll say hi to Akshay. Hey, Akshay. Hello, Sarah. Hello from London. And what I want to tell you is during the presentation, if you have a question, post it there in that chat, and we're going to have a question and answer session at the end of the presentation. So a little chat. And if you have any technical difficulties, the first thing you do, I mean, after you're going to put that in the chat and tell us, but what we're going to tell you to do is just hit that refresh button on your screen. Typically, that's going to reset things. And if you don't have a good connection, not to worry, we are recording this, and so you can watch it later. But if you have a question, feel free to post that there. And you know, Mary Lynn, I like to be very timely.
I know you do.
My Apple Watch is telling me that it is actually the top of the hour.
Okay.
So why don't we get started, and we'll present. Mary Lynn, you can first give us your presentation on the IFSCC. So, okay. Go ahead and do that.
So, hello, everybody. I'm Mary Lynn Halland. I'm the Secretary General of the IFSCC, and that stands for the International Federation of Societies of Cosmetic Chemists. We are 50 national societies and growing. Hello, and welcome to our newest society, the Society of Cosmetic Chemists. I'm sorry, Society of Cosmetic Scientists, Nigeria. They joined us last month during our YOCOMA virtual Congress. So welcome, Nigeria. We are dedicated to international cooperation in cosmetic science and technology. And to find your society, go to our website, ifscc.org, click on the member society link, and then this cute little map will pop up. You click on your country and up will pop information on your society. So if you're not already a member, that's how you find the society to join. When you join an IFSCC member society, you get these individual member benefits. We have a quarterly magazine we issue digitally. We have our COSMET database, which has nearly 100,000 papers, posters, magazine articles, presentations, etc., going back into the 80s. That is free for our IFSCC members. On our website, ifscc.org, we have a virtual library with reference books, textbooks, and articles, podiums and posters from all of our conferences and congresses starting in 1995, and recordings of these webinars. A lot of these materials, this is literally the only place you can find them. I'm talking about several of Perry's books, his textbooks that are out of print. This is the only place you can find them. As a member, you have opportunities to win prestigious prizes, including our special awards for young scientists. When the pandemic's over, we'll be again offering on-site educational programs in conjunction with your local society. And when you're a member, you save a lot of money on registration at our annual scientific congress or conference. So that's what we do. We're the IFSCC, One World of Beauty.